Hey guys! So for the next several days, I'm going to be focusing on the miracles of Christ. Examples of Christ showing that he had power, that God has power over the things that are physically broken and spiritually broken in this world. And so today's first story actually takes place pretty early on in Christ's ministry. In fact, at this point in the story, he hasn't even gathered his full 12 disciples. Matthew the tax collector is actually called by him right after this story. But already, Jesus has quite the reputation. People know that he speaks the word of God, that he can explain scripture with wisdom that astounds religious leaders who've been studying their whole entire lives. And he's already performed a couple miracles, and so people know that this guy is someone powerful, and people want to be near him to see what he's going to do and to hear what he says. And people who are sick are starting to come from far away or wherever they are to experience the possibility of being healed by him. And so what we see is, in Mark chapter 2, Jesus is in a house in Capernaum teaching. And a crowd gathers because word spreads quickly that he's there. And this house is so packed that no one else can even fit through the door. And so he's standing in the middle of this house teaching the word of God to all who will listen. When all of a sudden we read that these four guys come up with their friend who is a quadriplegic. I always say that word funny. He can't move his body, like nothing, he can't move. And so this man is on a mat and they've got him, if you can kind of envision the four friends on the four corners of this mat, carrying him in. And what they notice is there's no possible way that they are gonna fit through this crowd. I don't know how many of you have ever been at a big event, church service, or even a concert, maybe like Summerfest or a festival where there's people, crowds pouring in and like you can't get through. It's really hard, right? Well, you can kind of imagine their frustration. They can hear Jesus. They might even be able to kind of catch a glimpse of him over people's heads, but they can't reach him. And what they notice is there's a staircase up to the roof of this house, as is common at that time. And back then, roofs were made out of big tiles put in place that were then covered in, dirt or sod. But it was easy to manipulate them. They were flat. They weren't like tiled, shingled roofs at our like now. They were different. So these men see an opportunity, and they climb up on the roof, and they move the sod and the dirt away, and they start to lift these tiles until they see down below and realize that they are right above Jesus. And so they attach some ropes to the guy's mat and they start to lower him down through the ceiling. And Jesus notes the friend's faith and this man's faith for coming and asking for healing. And he turns to him and says, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now, this is a really powerful statement that he's making, and the religious leaders who are also listening, because they're skeptical of Jesus's message and they're watching him, and they hear him say this and they start to grumble and complain to themselves and say, "Who does this man think he is? Only God can forgive sins." And Jesus hears them and knows what they said and asks them, "What do you think is easier, to say, 'Son, your sins are forgiven,' or 'Rise up and walk'? But so that you might believe," he turns to them then and says, basically, "Watch," and commands the man to get up off his mat and to take it and walk. And the man does immediately, and he's healed. And I think the crazy thing about this story is, let's pause for a second and think about the fact that the first thing Jesus says is, "Your sins are forgiven." Jesus is identifying himself as God, as the Son of God, who has authority in heaven and on earth. And I think there's maybe some importance that we can pull from this, placed on forgiveness of sins, first and foremost, over even physical healing. It's the condition of our souls that ultimately matter most. And ultimately, that was why Christ came, was to pay the price for our sins so that we can be forgiven and made right. How many of you have ever really felt guilty for something? Maybe taken something that you weren't supposed to, or said something unkind and later regretted it, or gossiped about a friend and then, oh, Maybe they heard you, maybe they didn't, but later you felt bad about it. I hope I'm not alone, because I've felt guilty for a lot of things in my life that I've had to say sorry for. But here's the thing. Because of what Christ did, we get to be free from that guilt. When we confess our sins, the Bible says he is faithful and just to forgive us, to remove that burden of guilt, and to heal our hearts and our souls. Just like that man, he had his heart healed and then his physical body healed too that day. Because God is a God of miracles, and he has power over everything that is broken. Sin and physical brokenness too. Our God is powerful, and he did miracles then, and he does them now. So remember God's goodness, and when you're feeling that burden of guilt, remember that you can hand it to God. When you say, I'm sorry, maybe you have to say sorry to the people you hurt too, but when you say sorry and you repent, God takes that weight away. So let him free you from that. Have a great day, guys.